we have a one small demo. We created one states plugin in Honeycomb. So for introduction, Ravi will explain this in more detail, the VBP and Honeycomb things.
Since I'm seeing some new faces, let me go through the Honeycomb architecture. So this is the Honeycomb architecture. The Honeycomb architecture basically contains data management layer, and a layer below that will be a layer which will interact with the hardware and program the NICs. And that software will work on top of DPDK. DPDK is the network accelerator, packet accelerator from Intel. So it has, so whenever a packet comes in the file, it will be taken by this DPDK, and DPDK has some application mapping. So with that, it will be directly sent to the VPP, and VPP has logic on how to process that packet. So this is a general architecture. So in this architecture, Honeycomb exactly sits in the data plane management layer. So this is generic architecture. So you can replace this Honeycomb with any other module. So it only thing it should have is it should accept the netconf yang or REST interfaces. And it should convert into a lower layer layer. The small introduction to VPP is VPP. It's an open source project from Fast.io. So this VPP module runs on the user space, and it has a tree kind of plugin capability. So say for example, in a physical switch, if a packet comes, all the processing is scalar. The packet will be taken and it will go through each and every stage in the pipeline. Say the pipeline can have L2, L3, ACL, and then buffering, then rewriting some TTLs. So it will go to each stage. So because of that, your hardware L2 cache, there will be too much of instruction replacement. So the VPP folks, they have addressed this using a concept called they take the bunch of packets, okay, and what they do is they have their defined their own tree structure. So each tree node will be pointing to, say for example, L2 processing, L3 processing, or you can customize. They have given the option so that you can write your own tree, so that the packet will be processed only in your tree. So it because of this bunch of packet processing, they are saying it optimizes the L2 cache, hardware L2 cache. There is not too much of instruction swapping out of the L2 cache. So they are optimizing the hardware L2 cache. This is one optimization, and the other optimization, it works on top of DPDK. So eventually it is a fast packet processing. The packet will bypass the IP stack and it will go to the VPP application, which runs in the user space. So the whole setup will run in the bare metal server, VMR, it can be even a container. The only thing is that it should have a module which will program your hardware. Okay. So this is the general architecture of Honeycomb. And the ODL, if it wants to communicate with the Honeycomb architecture, it should either do through netconf or REST, or it can do a PGP speaker. So to do that, it should write some module, you know, which will take data from the ODL specific infrastructure module and pass it on to the other modules. So this is the high level overview of Honeycomb architecture. Any questions? Did you get about this Honeycomb architecture?
So when you said this,
Yeah. Yeah, so this VPP, they expose Java API interfaces. Say, for example, if the VPP has provision to configure an interface with MTU, it will expose a Java API for MTU, and that API will be called by this Honeycomb. The internal communication is, they say it's through some shared memory. They say there is a shared memory between these two, and as you said, yeah, you can do even RPC. Yeah, in netconf they have netconf this mounting facility, so wherein if you mount that device will be it's mount Honeycomb. Yeah, it's kind of abstracts out the underlying OPP. No, it doesn't support. Honeycomb is Java. This VPP exposes a Java API, and that API is called by this some module in Honeycomb.
GVP call the low level APIs.
So that either it can be low level API in the Java API or is the
C level API.
You can use JNI from Honeycomb side to call the C API.
You see, this low API is Java and then.
Next slide. So Honeycomb call the Java API. And this JVP has native calls. So JVM, JVPP run with this Honeycomb only. No, the VPP when compiled, it gives this JVP to, and we have this dependency in this Honeycomb. So. No, this is one process, Honeycomb. JVP is a part of Honeycomb.
Oh, it's a compiled library.
Compiled libraries.
have, I think, JDBC part, is there probably a JNI part?
JNI part.
Compile it in a bit, compile it, put it to the end user. And then they kind of, you know, call the other native interfaces using C to the English.
Yes. Yes, yes.
NetEIO is fine, but it's channel, right? But there, the interfaces is basically translated to JNI and CQ. Honeycomb plus the JNI interface, that actually calls the low level API of the VPD, which is basically C.
Okay, then Lalit will take over the session. Thanks.
But then how does the notification part work?
Yeah.
So the
translation. Yeah.
Maybe you can show them.
Details, but it's like once the notification comes, the same process back. It comes to JVPP, and JVPP converted and calls the whole form and eventually the reverse process.
So how
yes.
They
have one translation layer. So it
so
takes this.
What is it based on? You had some shared memory block there, right? So is
yeah.
it some shared memory IPC?
No, this is one application, this whole.
No, between the JVPP and the VPP.
The call is API, but they say it's based on some shared queue.
Shared.
This IPC communication, there is
IPC.
No way to kind of communicate because there you are exposing the CAPIs and then JVPP is natively called a JNI.
Mm-hmm.
Then either you should be part of the same process to call those API, or if you are different process,
then
the way,
IPC.
And
JVPP.
Yeah, because JVPP is a part of the translation layer plus this.
Okay. So this Honeycomb built on the same component as of ODL. So it has the YANG tool, MDSL, and this it provides a northbound interface in RESTConf and NetConf. So it take the request in the form of YANG modeling communication. And it has one transmission layer, and it converted to the low-level calls over to the JVP, and to the same with the reverse. So we have one translation here. So in Honeycomb VBD, it is an ODL application which is used to create the virtual bridge domain over to this VPP. So it is a it mount this Honeycomb agent as a NetConf device, and it is used to create a virtual bridge domain between two or more Honeycomb agents. Since it configure this VBD down to this Honeycomb agent, and which Honeycomb agent forward this request to the low level VPP. Then this is one other application. ODL is a time series data repository. So this TSDR application capture the states data from the ODL and store in a persistent data. So data includes states, counters, performance data, health, states information, and operational data. And this data can be used by other application over the TSDR. So this application includes performance analysis, security risk detection, and operational configuration optimization. And
so how this is related to the VPP? Because I know the TSDR basically, I know it has a support for overflow,
yes.
Yes. But does it collect for the Honeycomb and VPP?
So that is proposed. That is proposal. So it can, right now it's collecting data for OpenFlow, NetConf, Syslog, and SNMP. It's as a time series data, so it's like a particular time this data.
Yeah.
So the main intention is you collect the VPP data and put it in MDSL, then the TSDR can act on it, can use that data.
So as of now, TSDR, the way it's working, OpenFlow plugin collect all the stats
yeah.
for MDSL and then actually get the data from the data store and then they
yeah. The same thing
yeah,
will
same
be
thing.
Followed
yeah,
here.
Yeah.
So there will be application in ODL, VBD. Virtual Bridge Domain. So that application will collect the data from the Honeycomb VPP and put that data in MDSL.
And then DSDR will
yeah. TSDR can do whatever processing you want.
So it means adding new feature in the VBD for collecting the states and new feature in TSDR for VPP states. For persisting the data, states data. This data in MDSL is not persisting.
It's actually you have the data, you have to process, right? So
send. No, will the data be any different if it was received from an OVS, directly from HP versus from Honeycomb? No, right?
No.
TSDR itself doesn't need to change.
No, but if there are more counters coming from VPP, right? So that data has to be sent to some Hadoop for data analytics, it has to send, right? So it's sending that data, there has to be some change in TSD.
Honeycomb is the agent that is actually collecting it. The switch is just sending whatever counter that goes to Honeycomb to the translation.
But today, VBD must have some stack collection thing which is putting, collecting those stacks from VBD.
No, it's currently not there. So,
VBD. Not there at all.
Yeah. Yeah, it should.
So that itself is not very good.
Yeah, VBD currently just configures tunnels, add ports.
So the four states requirements for throughput, delay, packet loss in the VPP network, QS parameters met, and also continuously monitoring all the flows between predefined link destination pairs on throughput, packet loss and delay, and monitoring packet in and packet out counters. And Honeycomb VBD states design. So in this design proposal, we are proposing the enhancement on the components in the VPP and Honeycomb agent and VBD and TSDR. So VPP right now support two counters, IP version 4 FIB and IP version 6 FIB counters, but these counters support also not yet fully implemented in JVPP. So one proposal is enhancement of states counter in VPP. Then Honeycomb agent should be able to poll these counters and provide in a Yang modeling, the Yang description data. And VBD should be able to poll this data periodically and put it in the MDSL. And TSDR will persist that data from the MDSL. So in VPP, this counters to be added, it is not there. Honeycomb agents, the same thing. Okay, in the VBD, it will to collect this stage data from the Honeycomb agent, and also means it will periodically query the stage data, and it could be configurable and stored in the MDSL. And the same thing, the TSDR will collect it from the MDSL and save it as a time series data in its persistent data store. And this data could be available through MDSR commands and will be made available for any other northbound application over TSDR. So we implemented some POC, implemented a small states plugin. So for this is the, we have already discussed that OpenDelight this VBD application mount the Honeycomb as a netconf. So we implemented for Honeycomb, they provide plugin development. So it's a set of instructions. So you can add the new functionality to Honeycomb. So this is the layer, this is a Honeycomb plugin. So you can upgrade this thing, adding your new functionality. So it provides a CRUD things. You can write new reader and writer here. So for our demo, we just need the readers. So we implemented one REST GET API over to it. Yes, it's
yeah.
So VBD just say, you know, make a put request to mount the device, and basically a network protocol.
Yeah, network.
You can show the command.
It's just a wrapper layer that actually mount it and configure it.
Yes.
So it's not creating any specific mount point within a VBD. They don't really have any network.
Yeah.
Okay, hold on a second.
So right now, as we don't have VPP states, so we are using some dummy variables. And we are using for Honeycomb, we are using 16.9 stable build.
Since the counter support is not there in JVPP, we have just put a stub in the Honeycomb itself to retrieve some static data.
We install the VPP on the virtual machine as a binary, but we also have the source code to get the JVP, compile it. So we implemented a new state distribution over the Honeycomb and started. Then in ODL, you install this ODL VBD UI feature, and there's one script provided. So for mounting this Honeycomb in the ODL, so you run this script, then we run this REST command over the Honeycomb and ODL, and got the data. So this is the YAG model we are using for our POC. So it has a states plugin module, and we are implementing one counter REST GET API. It has a states plugin parameters. These are only two parameters. One is the interface ID, and the other one is the counter name. So we'll show the demo.
So the key ID is just an interface number. It uniquely identifies the interface. And the other parameters will be the counter, which is associated with the interface. Any questions still here? It's like there is one team which is trying to integrate VPP into our switch. So so that's for our new generation switch. So that proposal is accepted by our top level management, then they'll continue to port this. Yeah. We have like two VMs, and in one VM we have VPP and Honeycomb running, and in the other VM we will run Open Delete Controller.
So we are running the VPBHS service, and this is the one distribution over to the Honeycomb. So we are running it. Honeycomb provides a means both interface testconf and netconf. So we are sending a request on REST. So it's returning that counter value. So this is one part of our POC.
So RESTconf actually lands an ODL and ODL talks to Honeycomb infrastructure and get this detail.
Yeah, no, this request is for directly to Honeycomb. So I will show how it go to the ODL. Yes. Same component it use MDSL, Young tools.
So it's like you are doing a double, right? You have one to get you store in Honeycomb and then you take it from there. And when you gain you store in open daylight data store again, because there are two data store, right? One in Honeycomb agent, one in open daylight control agent, right?
But the thing is that we cannot directly interact with the VPP. So we sending a request to the Honeycomb only. So in ODL we are getting this data for persistent. In Honeycomb it will not persist also.
No, operational data is anyway not persistent in ODL controller also, right? My point is you are using ODL controller and then you are using Honeycomb, right? Honeycomb also have MD cell and the ODL controller also have MD cell, right? So first Honeycomb will fetch all those things and put into their operational data store at Honeycomb level. Then you send the request to Honeycomb to get the data from that Honeycomb MD cell,
yeah.
And then you will put into controller MD cell.
Yeah.
It's a double write there. Once you put there, that TSDR will listen and it will put into persistent data store, right?
Yeah.
This is how it's done.
Yeah.
But anyway, you have Honeycomb agent is something you are mounting in open device controller. Why you have to make a REST call for that? You can internally read it just right into it. It's like mounted, right? Already mounted in the controller.
Yeah, that will show. We'll directly send a REST call to the ODL controller. So this Honeycomb architecture is a generic architecture, so it can work with ODL or without ODL. So it's so in either case it needs the MD cell kind of implementation. Yeah, there will be the two write problem will be there.
Means it can be other state collector over Honeycomb that can work over this.
But then why did you VBD have to call this stats and ask TSDR to write it? Like, why not TSDR directly go to the Honeycomb and fetch it from there and write it first?
No, TSDR take the data from MDSL only, no?
No, it takes from MDSL because that's where you store it. But in this architecture, what will happen is you are getting data is already in Honeycomb data store. You get it and put it to MD cell data store, right? That write is unnecessary because your TSDR, you can modify TSDR, you can write a whole folder or whatever. It actually can go to your Honeycomb device, fetch directly from it, and put it to the data store, right? you don't really want the data to be persistent for every device to be, or you want it for some reason. Because I don't really see a reason, because Honeycomb already processes it. Now you are duplicating a data at two places and then eventually it's going to the persistent device. Right? So it's a two, right? One at Honeycomb level, then a controller level, and then it goes to TSDR. So okay. I was thinking, is there any use case for keeping that data in open device controller itself or not? Because eventually, whatever application you will write for this thing, you have to go to TSDR, fetch all the time series data and do the analytics on that, even in a Hadoop case, right?
Yeah.
So Hadoop case, you procure the data from the TSDR, and because you are not going to go to OpenDLite controller and get this test data, because it's the latest data, which is not going to work for Hadoop. That's why I'm wondering, why not just fetch it from TSDR? TSDR just fetches directly from the Honeycomb and put it into data. So you will avoid one writing.
Okay. So instead of VBD, it can direct data.
Yeah. And you can make it, you know, multi-threaded. So if you have multiple devices, you can reach out to different devices and write in a different way, right? Because otherwise, what you have to do is, one device looks fine. But if you have multiple devices, your OpenDL controller will have to fetch from everyone, and you have to write the similar kind of data from different Honeycomb agents.
Okay.
One centralized data store, right? And
okay.
That can be a painful. The performance is going to degrade and all that. You can write a multi-threaded renderer in the TSDR, fetch all the device and directly write to S2S, which is in memory and which is faster, and then you can slowly process it.
Okay.
So, in a way, it's more secure. So, yeah, it's putting into controller database is good, but I don't really see any use case why we want to put that. So that data is going to sit there. It's a temporary data.
Yeah.
You don't have to take that.
Okay, then you need some modification in TSDR directly interacting with this.
It's a REST call, right?
Okay.
Showing this mount. Pushing the mount. It's not showing the mount. Oh, did you mount? Yeah, I mounted. So, I'm going to connect. Okay. Did I change this? Seems to be some problem. Actually, we mounted the Honeycomb in ODL, then it shows in a mounted device. Then we are able to do the get over here. So it's not working. We have to. No, it will not work.
They have integrated this. VBD is integrated to.
OpenDL.
Yeah.
And you are talking to VBD.
Yeah.
It will show here one mount device. So due to some configuration issues, it's not showing. So that's it.
Okay, I will try. Yeah, that's it from my from our side.
Actually, we have to read the data directory in the ODL, then again we have to launch and mount it. Yeah, so it will take some time. So if we have this mount script,
so can you just show the mount script?
Yeah. So it takes three parameters. ODL IP, VPP host, and VPP IP, and so simple script, just run with this parameter, it will show in the VBD UI here. And so you have to install one feature, this ODL VBD UI in the ODL, then it will work.
Thank you guys.